deer this year. You know, gave one to my dad, and I've got a couple here. They're gonna join me on the adventure of butchering some deer for the first time on my own. So, thanks for joining me. Covered a table in cardboard and wax paper to make sure we don't get any stuff on our nice table. You're going to want a few different kinds of knives. You're going to want a knife for chopping, something that might be able to get through some bone and some thick meat. A knife for slicing, getting around some bones, you know, deboning stuff. And then a good knife for skinning, just an all-around good pokey knife. A cutting board. You'll want some freezer tape to close your packaging and to mark. And so you'll also want a marker. You want some water handy. Plenty of plastic bags, garbage bags, and nitrile gloves. Always at the ready because you're going to poke through a lot of those too. Keep a basin here so that when I get hair on the meat, I can rinse it off. And then some paper towels and a nice clean open area where you can bag stuff up, package it, and get ready to go. So the first thing you're going to want to do is skin the deer. So you need to hang your deer up. For that, we've got a gramble system. It's got a hanging point for the back of the deer's legs and a pulley system to lift. So we have to make a way to attach it to the gramble. It goes in behind the tendon, and here you just make a little slip. That's why you want a nice sharp pokey knife. And then again over here. And then I always like to have a piece of paper towel handy just so whenever a knife blade touches hair, you can wipe it off real quick and make sure it's clean so you're not going to get any hair on any meat. And you've got these points on the gravel that you just, on the yoke, you should just be able to shove up through your stabbing points. There's one. And what this helps do is keep the legs spread so you can work inside the pelvis and down the backbone and stuff while you're skinning it. There we go. Alright, so we're hooked through. Oh, I should just go straight to this roof. Actually, that's probably enough height. Figure out what I'm going to tie off. Trying to just get in here, wherever you can, to make a hole. I mean, it's a weird way to think about it, but really, like, that's all your skin is, you know? It's a sack that holds you together. Because the deer is just in a skin suit. And the reason you start this far up is because you see that? That's just a tendon. And so you're not spoiling any meat if you cut into that. So you can get into there and really get your knife going. Starting it is the hardest part.
I mean, now I feel after doing this whole process.
Doing what? I've done this before. This isn't actually my first time doing this. This is just my first time doing it without my dad standing there telling me exactly what to do. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's an important part of the adventure and growing up. You know, not having my dad, who used to be an apprentice butcher, standing over me telling me exactly where to put my knife blade and if I'm doing it right. You're really just kind of doing your best, you know? Trying to remember all the stupid little stuff he told you while you were like, oh god, I just want to get it done. Why can't I just... Gee, Billy, why can't I just slice through this tendon? Because... then the deer would just fall down. You need the tendon to hold it up. You don't really want to hold the knife back here. You want to hold it up here. You just want, you know, something to work with. So you see that technique there? You know how I gut deer? The grip it and rip it, as you would call it? It's just all about how much downforce you can put on it. So all this silver skin, you want to pull off all the stuff under it, all the, as much of this layer as you can get, because it all has to come off anyway. And so, you know, the more you can get now, the easier it is later. But I pretty much just grip it and rip it. My dad's all about going in and cutting it real slow and easy, but at a certain point, you just gotta get it done. So this is the layer you're aiming for. That's essentially what holds the skin on. trying to get in there and slowly slice it into places you can't tear free. And then it's like cutting a suit off someone. Here's the crotch of the suit. Clearly, you know, I'm not going to be able to just tear a skin suit off you if you have a crotch on still. So I'm just going to slice through and make sure that's released to get out of there. Oh, is that even the back section that got hit? I think this is the ass section that was hurt. It's all fucked up.
That's how you know it's bad?
No. I just think that something could hit that before. And when it starts doing that, you just come through. Start to use your knife more. After you get to the tail, you have to get through the bone and the spine. So I just use a sawzall and give it a quick. Give it a quick zap. You can see here, we've lost some big chunks of meat because this, he was in a fight and got gored in the butt. And so we had some pus coming out of mostly skin sacs, but there was one section right here that like fell apart when I took it off, and I just cut the big section out because I don't want to deal with that. But yeah, once you just sawzall through the tail, the rest of this just follows up the backbone and you just slice it through. I don't know what you thought processing a deer would be like, but I'm sure this is enough to make you take every deer you get into a processor. I don't care. Meat's not a science, it's an art. The ultimate goal is to get meat on my table. All that I trimmed off is going to get thrown in the stew burger bag, and then that is a piece of meat. I'm going to slice that up into some chops or something. First, I'm going to go through and take off all these little pieces of silver skin and fat and make sure it's a good, clean piece of meat ready to go when I package it. Once you've taken a piece of meat off the deer and you cleaned it up a little, you just take the ends off. You know, the little pieces that are going to be a little small to be chops or whatever, and that can get put in stew meat. And you know, you just line yourself up a half inch, 3/4 inch chop. This river king's killing me.
Hey, look.
Okay, so a little bit of some medallion chops. So I'll package these in a package of four. So on the cling wrap, I'll put two together. Make sure it's really clinging and got the air out of it. And I'll put two more on top and unroll it. Make sure it's really clinging and gotten together. And you want to push all the air out as much as you can. Because the air is what makes your meat go bad, freeze or burn, and taste weird. So then, put it in a convenient, you know, that's the smallest way I can freeze four chops. Then I take a little parchment paper, tear it off, put it in here, wrap it up. I take a little of the freezer tape, a little stick. My tape doesn't stick. That's annoying as hell. Tape sticks to itself really cool.